advised. You are about to become a witness.
Look at Mama's baby!
A new mom, beaming with pride.
Her name's Kaylina Nicole McBride.
Already making plans for her daughter's future.
I want her to live on the streets. You know, I want her to live my type of life.
This is the legacy Spider is creating for her six-week-old baby here on the streets of Hollywood, where life is clearly unscripted.
I gave my daughter to her and switched for her dog.
And kids don't seem to give much thought to alternatives.
I'm disenchanted by life, I guess. It's not my thing.
I've overdosed more than 22 times. And if I've pulled through that many times, you know, I'm not going to die of an overdose that easily.
How do they survive?
You guys could spare anything, please. I've got nowhere to go.
Will this street family stay together? Is this teen fit to be a parent?
You know, I was a foster kid from 8 years old and up, dude. Y'all the ones my life. You want to take my daughter from me?
Captured on camera, invisible people.
The streets ain't nothing nice.
On any given day in America, there are nearly 1.5 million kids living on the streets. Each year, reality hits home for thousands of runaways under the bright lights of Hollywood, where many homeless teens live on discarded food and an endless supply of cheap heroin. They'll tell you in their own raw language that being a street kid is about as tough as it gets, perhaps toughest for the newborn you're about to meet.
No one comes to Hollywood to see them, but an estimated 7,000 to 8,000 homeless teens and young adults live right here under the famous letters on the hill among the stargazers and the wannabes.
Could you guys please spare anything for food? I just got here from Hawaii and I've got nowhere to go. I don't know anybody here, please.
On the streets for just a few months, Brittany and Jason are finding Hollywood not all it's cracked up to be.
I have absolutely no resources. It's gotten really bad.
And 21-year-old Allison knows how bad it can get.
Sometimes you gotta do shit you don't wanna do to survive in life. I mean, it's reality, man. You don't like it, but you know what? You gotta do it anyway.
Tom, a drifter from Denver, came here by chance.
Some crackhead sold me his bus ticket to L.A. for $5.
17-year-old Al is an innocent to these streets.
I never did it. Heroin or speed till I came here.
These are the faces of America's invisible generation.
I've been running the streets out here since 11. Everyone knows me as Spider. Here's my tattoos.
Theirs is a Hollywood few ever experience.
Can you guys spare change for beer? We need, like, just a little bit more to get drunk.
Spare changing. Spanging for a buck.
Thanks, bro.
Breaking, entering, and trespassing. Squatting for a bed.
Sometimes you go days without eating. The streets ain't nothing nice.
But 19-year-old Spider is thrilled to be here. After a long absence, she's finally back on the boulevard.
We're all a big family here. We've all known each other for a long time. I know
Baby.
Scotty and his
Baby.
Brother, Looney. I met them at Jack in the Box. That was about 4 or 5 years ago. This is a friend of mine. I just met him tonight. He's cool. He's great.
He's a
maybe a boyfriend. Yeah, maybe. All right, this is my beloved Lovey sister. Ooh, she's so sweet to me. We've been knowing each other for about six years now.
Allison and Spider may not be related by blood, but for this moment in time, they are family.
We're trying to stick together because she has nowhere to go. She has no family either. So we were trying to make it together, you know, me and her.
There is little Spider and Allison can't handle when it comes to making it out here. But these days, there's a new kid on the block, and she comes with a whole new set of problems.
Her name's Kaylina Nicole McBride.
It's been just 6 weeks since Spider gave birth to little Kaylina, and already she's inherited a legacy, surviving the boulevard.
I want her to live on the streets. You know, I want her to live my type of life.
Kaylina is the newest member of this family, which, like all others, comes with its own set of dynamics. Spider plays the fun-loving child to Allison, who's known as a street mom. She takes care of everyone but herself.
All right, let's roll, people.
Allison's fondness for Kaylina is one of the few cracks in her armor. Her own baby girl died shortly after birth, and she can't believe Spider wants Kaylina to sleep outside.
There ain't nothing wrong squatting. There ain't nothing wrong with squatting, but I don't want her out here because I don't want the f***ing cops to be taking her.
You know, if it's my little girl, if I want her on the streets, it's going to be on the streets. That's my choice. It's my decision.
I don't want her on the streets. I don't want her being taken.
She's not going to be taken, dude. As long as people run their mouths, they're not going to, nothing's going to be said. Our little girl's not going to be taken.
Distressed, Allison makes a call to a good friend in Oakland, whom she's planning to visit within days.
I don't know what to do about this child. This woman is sitting here saying that if she wants her kid to squat, her kid's going to squat. She's got a six-week-old baby. I mean, just the thought of having a six-week-old child on the side of a freeway is tearing me apart.
And despite her bravado, Spider lives every moment with the fear that Kaylina could be taken away by the state of California's Child Protective Services.
I hope and pray they don't. I hope they all see and realize that I'm doing the best I can at 19.
As much as she fears the powers that be, she, like the ever-growing number of young mothers, would not survive without the social service system. And Spider knows how to work it to her advantage.
I'm all weak and they provide formula for me and juice and cereal. Salvation Army, they help me provide for diapers. Tonight I got all these blankets here at the weigh-in. They're all Pooh Bear, really nice stuff. You know, it's all brand new. I go to parenting classes and they help me, give me clothes and pacifiers and stuff I need.
I'm trying to change, sir. Trying to get diapers for our kid.
Can you guys spare some change tonight?
Allison talks Spider into spanging up enough money for a motel room.
Thank you.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 36.
That's so good.
We need like about 10 more and we got a room.
With just a few more dollars to go, Spider decides enough is enough. Regardless of Allison's efforts to the contrary, they will squat outside, baby and dog included, in an empty lot and save their money for another day.
I've squatted like 2 nights ago with her, and she loved it.
That's what she wants the baby to be. She wants it to be a natural born squatter.
Spider knows being homeless is not a crime. Neglecting your child is. And for Spider, it's all in the definition.
Neglect is when you're beating your child has no clothes, your child is filthy, your child is hungry, ain't got no food. My baby has everything she needs.
Coming up.
This is not what I was raised to be, and so it's like, I've gotten to like my all-time low, you know?
Back at the squat, Spider and the gang are getting ready for bed.
I have blankets at the yin-yang for her, and I don't see no harm in it.
I don't mind sleeping outside. It doesn't bother me. It doesn't bother my little one either.
I fucking hate it, but like she told me earlier, it's my child. I'll do whatever I want with it.
Excuse me? I just got here from Hawaii, and I'm trying to get a hotel room. If you guys could spare anything, please. I've got nowhere to go.
Though a relative newcomer to Hollywood, 17-year-old Brittany is as street smart as they come. 5 years younger than her boyfriend Jason, it is she who runs their show on the boulevard.
Move out of the way. Move out of the way. Excuse me?
Brittany is a master spanger.
It's across the street.
She has spared changing down to a science.
Big bills work too. They're good. They're great. Big bills are really great. They help me for a long time.
People stereotype people, and I'm like dressed like a little girl and all innocent.
You're just too young and sweet to be out here on the street.
It's a lot. Your dollar will really get me into a hotel room, man.
I don't like panhandling from people. It's not honest. I make it up that I've only been here a few days, you know. I've been here quite a while and could have got my shit together, but drugs have slowed me down. That's the truth.
And drugs are precisely why she and Jason made the long haul from Hawaii to Hollywood.
First of all, the dope's cheaper here, and there's dope here. You know, we were sick of sitting in Hawaii, and every 4 days they ran out of dope, and we got deathly ill. And we were sick of paying $50 a pop for it when it's $6 a pop over here, you know? Figure if I'm gonna do drugs, I may as well do them right, you know?
But ironically, Brittany and Jason have come to do something else they know is right. Check themselves into drug rehab to get off heroin for good.
I mean, I wanted to be clean when I got here, but not that much. I mean, now it's just like to the point where every day I'm thinking about it. You know, I only get high because I have to sit on the sidewalk and
You know, there's nothing to do. It's just like boredom. You know, I'm just like, I'm lying to God and myself, you know, and I just like feel guilty about it. Oh man, I scored.
Nonetheless, it's been a successful night.
Oh, this is so great. We needed this, man. We got tomorrow night nearly taken care of. Give me my purse. Purse. $43, man. Nice.
Brittany and Jason call it a night. They will squat in a spot they feel lucky to have found.
All the way back. All the way back.
A ramp on a soon-to-be-finished hotel.
Yeah, there's a big sign outside that says, sleep here soon, but we just figured we'd sleep here now.
I guess my life's gone down a little bit. You know, we're like literally sleeping right on the sidewalk. When I was in Hawaii, I didn't think of myself as homeless, you know, and like, I have like a lot of morals, you know, like I don't, this is bad for me.
No, for dessert.
This is not what I was raised to be, and so it's like, I've gotten to like my all-time low, you know?
There are lots of kids that have come to this city who said they would never be homeless, or would never sleep in an abandoned building, or would never eat out of a garbage can, and you know, a year later find themselves doing those things.
No one knows what these kids face better than Brian Bob. Part parent and all friend, he heads the street outreach program of Hollywood's Covenant House, where he's worked for 11 years. 7 nights a week, you can find him and his team out here among the tourist trolleys and the limos, cruising the boulevard in his red van.
We represent a moment of sanity for a lot of them in an otherwise chaotic life, you know, let alone a chaotic day.
It's good to see you like this.
Yeah.
Like, usually when I see you, you're kind of depressed. But a brother, he
brought some smiles in your life.
On a typical evening, he runs into 40 to 60 kids. Many of them are new faces.
Hey, what's your name?
Columbia.
You win with that name. That is a good name.
Where are you from, Columbia?
Kansas.
Would you like a sandwich or something to drink?
Yeah.
Gotcha. How long have you been in Los Angeles?
About 4 months.
Hey, you know what? This guy over here named Jose has sodas and sandwiches. Why don't you grab one from him, and he's going to give you a card and let you know what we do. Okay, baby girl?
You know, all of a sudden they run across a person who says, hey, what's going on with you? Let me talk to you about you. And I want nothing from you other than your being okay. Who's that right there?
I heard you. I knew that was your voice. I was here. Covenant House!
Kids will see you and be like, wow, you're still here. And I look back at them and go, the problem is you're still here.
This is not cute, sleeping on a bus bench. And y'all both know this.
They don't trust systems. They don't trust programs.
Y'all be good, okay?
So, you know, you've got to hold their hand in hopes that one day when they're ready to trust, you can start opening the door to them slightly until it's completely open.
A new day has dawned in Hollywood. Spider and baby Kaylina made it through their night of squatting under the stars to tell the tale.
When I squatted with her outside, I felt like home. You know, I felt that I felt comfortable. I felt like I was doing the right thing. You know, she was warm, she was taken care of. I still got up in the middle of the night to feed her. I didn't neglect her.
And for Spider, there's no better proof than that social services is still not on her trail.
When I gave birth to my little girl, I thought about adoption, but right now I think I'm doing good, so I don't think I need to give her up right now. I think I'm doing okay.
Coming up.
I've overdosed more than 22 times, and if I've pulled through that many times, you know, I'm not going to die of an overdose that easily.
It's a new day, but for Brittany and Jason, it's an old routine. They're on the go, heading nowhere.
When I first started doing drugs, my mom was all willing to help me. She says, I'll take you on vacation. You can get away from here, you can stop doing drugs, I quit cold turkey, stay clean the whole time. The first day we get home, my stepdad, he goes, we got a new set of rules here. Your boyfriend, we don't want him on the property anymore. It was all his fault I was on drugs. Even though I got on drugs way before I met him, you know, I got him started back on drugs, actually. When I met him, he was clean. So we split, and he left, and we went and got high.
And getting high here has its advantages. Hollywood's needle exchange, Clean Needles Now, is a regular stop for Brittany and Jason. Partially funded by the city, the service was founded in 1993. Some find it controversial, claiming it promotes drug use. But exchanges like this one have been proven to stop the spread of disease. And here, addicts like Brittany and Jason can trade in dirty needles for clean ones.
What size do you want? 27?
Do you have 27 here?
Yes.
I got their needles, but they might want something.
Yeah, we want Tides, Crookers, Cottons, Waters.
Anything else?
No.
You know, my mom, she just sits over there and worries. She worries her ass off about me. She thinks I'm getting loaded and I'm going to die and all these things, you know, and I'm sleeping on the streets here, and I don't want her to think that. So I tell her I got a job, and I told her, you know, that I was doing good a long time ago. I mean, now I'm kind of starting to do better, but I'm still not clean yet.
But getting clean isn't so simple. Fearing the terrible pain of withdrawal, going cold turkey is not an option. Brittany, still a minor, can't legally enter a methadone clinic until her 18th birthday, just a few days away. And though 22-year-old Jason is getting a daily dose of methadone from a clinic, he still can't make it through the day without shooting up heroin. Kicking the habit isn't easy for anyone.
I was clean for like 5 months in Denver until I came out here. Really pisses me off that I'm stupid enough to go back into it, but at the same time, you know, it's too tempting while I'm out here.
Black tar heroin flows so abundantly across the border from Mexico, it seems impossible for this 21-year-old from Denver, known as Junkie Tom, to avoid.
I had heard the consequences, but I didn't believe that anything was that bad. I thought that I'd be able to quit anytime I want because I thought human will is the strongest thing there is, but I learned a lot about my will. I thought my will was a lot stronger then than it is now.
Since his arrival in Hollywood 5 months ago, Tom has been hanging with another street veteran and fellow junkie, 22-year-old Lori from Connecticut.
When I came here, I just started doing a lot of speed because everybody does speed.
And I stopped doing speed, and then I started doing heroin again. And now I just do whatever.
Anybody can eat this.
In the last few weeks, Tom and Laurie have taken a new kid under their wing, 17-year-old Al from Brooklyn, New York.
When I came here to Hollywood, like, I was on the street and I didn't know shit about Hollywood. Tom showed me everything. Showed me squats, showed me who to trust, who not to.
And whether intentional or not, Tom also introduced Al to heroin. A drug Al had never tried before he came to Hollywood just 2 weeks ago.
He said to me one day, oh, I want to try it. So he tries it once. He said, I'm just going to do it once. And then I'm done with it. He did it once. And then he did it like later that day. And then the next day he went out on his own and copped it. Did it again without me knowing.
Tom doesn't want Al emulating his junkie lifestyle. But tonight, Tom did not prove a very good example. He was just released from the hospital after a heroin overdose.
I've overdosed more than 22 times. And if I've pulled through that many times, you know, I'm not going to die of an overdose that easily.
Though he is blasé about his own drug use, he is angry when it comes to Al's.
You see why I'm pissed off at Al for trying to do this?
I know. I told him. He knows how to.
He's trying to become a junkie on purpose.
He's not. No, he's not.
He's basically saying I'm looking for an image of... a junkie, and like, I think that's kind of ridiculous. How could anybody want something like that? It's wanting poison. My own they wasted their lives on heroin. They're gone now, you know. AIDS and all that jail. That's what came of it.
But Al is struggling with much more than a possible drug problem.
I try to kill myself. I just got out of the sanitarium after staying there about 8 months. I've been through a lot, and like sometimes I just feel like everything's dead, you know? I just wake up and I'm like, what the f*** is there to walk around for, you know?
Kids on the street do get support from at least 10 different Hollywood organizations, which cater to their varied needs. They come to these agencies for everything from clean socks to parenting classes, one-on-one counseling and internet access, or simply to rest up from the previous night. Today, Spider and her new boyfriend, Rock, are at the popular center, My Friend's Place. But six-week-old Kaylina is conspicuously absent.
I had people try to take my daughter from me, saying that I was being neglectful because I was squatting with my baby.
Child Protective Services did catch up with Spider.
They checked the baby over. They stripped, you know, they stripped her totally down, diaper, everything. They said that she was not look like be appeared to be beaten. They said I had diapers, formula, everything I needed, but they said the housing thing was what was their main concern. But I told them that in a week I should be able to get into a place. They said that I need to have a place tonight and right now, and I didn't have one.
Fearing that little Kaylina would be whisked away by the state, Spider made an unusual pact with her friend Allison, who was temporarily going out of town.
And I gave my daughter to her and switched for her dog. So I made a deal with her. If anything happens to my daughter while she's gone, while me and my daughter are parted, that I would kill her dog. And so her dog means a lot to her, so that was the agreement.
Coming up.
You know, I was a foster kid from 8 years old and up, dude. Y'all the one f***ed up my life, and you want to take my daughter from me?
Streets of Hollywood have attracted young runaways for years. 4 out of 5 homeless teens there see the streets as their only escape from abusive families. But all of them quickly learn the life of a street kid is anything but a picnic. Add a baby into the mix and things get complicated quickly. Fearing social services was about to catch up with her, 19-year-old Spider sent her newborn away with a friend for a few days, but now she thinks it's safe to bring the baby home.
I'm waiting for my 6-week-old baby, Kaylina Nicole McBride, to come here. She's with my best friend, Allison, who's on that bus right there, coming in right now.
In Kaylina's absence, Spider has been applying for housing benefits. She now has enough money to pay for a motel for a few nights.
Getting bigger every time I see you. You got a bottle made?
No, I gotta make one for
it. Spider is certain that with her newfound benefits, little Kaylina will be here to stay.
They need to see her before they give me all my benefits. As soon as they give me the benefits, I'll be up in the hotel. My rent will be paid. We'll be able to go buy groceries and everything.
Isn't she a little angel?
Not only has Spider found lodging in the short time Kaylina's been away, she's also found her baby a daddy.
You ain't holding her right. First off, she's spitting up all over you because you ain't doing it right. Third off, you're letting her feet all scrunch up. Man, you don't know. Ooh, wait.
Though Rock has been her boyfriend for less than a week, they're already engaged.
We're going to take Kaylina down to Hollywood Boulevard. So I got a whole bunch of gutter punk friends who want to meet her and see her.
Just when Spider thinks she's in the clear, Child Protective Services catches up with her once again.
Spider?
Yes, I am. Okay. We need to talk.
Come over here for a moment. Why do we need to talk?
CPS has been lying in wait, tipped off that on a bus arriving from Oakland is a young mother whose baby is reportedly suffering from dehydration.
That's kind of funny because my daughter's got formula and water.
Where do you live?
I live at the hotel right over there on La Brea and Hollywood in room 101. I got the hotel key with me.
Okay.
And AFDC is putting me up in the Roslyn Hotel on Monday. At my appointment is at 8 o'clock with Paul to get on my AFDC so y'all can't take my daughter. Sorry. Mama's not yelling at you.
In the company of police, who are there merely to ensure order, it is this social worker's unenviable responsibility to enforce a law which is ambiguous at best. Is little Kaylina suffering neglect?
I have legal rights. This is my daughter. She is not sick, and you need to get out of my business.
Calm down.
The social worker, sensing her increasing aggression, asks the cops to call their supervisor for additional help. In the meantime, he tries calmly to reason with Spider.
We have information that she was sick.
She was not sick, dude.
Okay.
Well, you guys are making her sick by asking your mother. And y'all need to leave me alone. He's saying that my daughter's sick and she's got some kind of disease or something, that I haven't taken care of her. and I have rights. I have no warrants. I have nothing. I have no warrants. I don't have a damn record. I don't have a record. And I've been a street kid for 11 years.
Baby, relax. Will you get in trouble, please?
That's f***ed up. They're doing this to me. This is so f***ed up. You are f***ed up, dude. I went in the foster care system. You people are f***ed up. You know, I was a foster kid from 8 years old and up, dude. Y'all the one f***ed up my life. And you want to take my daughter from me? Y'all are f***ed up. My daughter's just fine and just happy.
Is this Sergeant Smith that's going to be coming? Is he on duty right now?
You know what's going to do to me if they take Kaylina? You know what's going to do to me? Do you know what it's going to do to me if they take Kaylina? This dude's trying to take my daughter from me.
Even Brittany can't take charge of this situation.
I'm not on the street. She's got everything she needs. I'm living in a hotel. My daughter's not. Does she look like she's sick? Does it look like she's been abused? Ever since day one, the day I gave birth 6 weeks ago, they've been trying to pull her out of my arms. Because I'm only 19 years old. They've been trying to yank her from my arms.
With the supervising officer now on site, the cops pull Spider aside, hoping to convince her to cooperate.
Okay. Let's go over here and talk.
Are you who's in charge?
No, my sergeant is, but I'm just going to ask you a couple questions, okay? Where are you staying right now?
You know, on La Brea in Hollywood, there's a...
Right now, what's your address?
All right. Asshole. They're going to take me all the way up to the hotel and make sure I have a place to stay. Watch all my stuff. I'll be right back.
Spider is anxious to get into her motel room. She's sure that once she shows the police documents proving that she's found shelter, little Kaylina will not be taken away.
You gotta turn left right now. Excuse me? Mom, is the older man here? Can you please open my room, please? Thank you. It's right over here, please. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
But Spider's paperwork isn't enough. Two paramedics are called to the scene to examine the baby, and that's not sufficient either. Finally, it's decided that Kaylina will be escorted to Children's Hospital, where she will be given a full battery of tests.
They want to just do it and make sure. I'm a good future gutter punk. Keep telling.
After several hours, Spider emerges from the hospital with Rock at her side.
Just said baby's fine. Perfectly healthy. Healthiest baby they ever seen.
She's furious. She's defiant. But she still has the baby.
The whole world. They want to take her? I'm ready. I'm ready.
Coming up.
Who do we as a world think is picking these people up? You know, these people aren't prostituting to themselves. These people are prostituting to the husbands and fathers of this country.
It's another Saturday night, and the kids are just hanging on the boulevard before the evening really gets started. Al's new haircut hasn't changed him much. Desperate for companionship, he clings to Tom. And it's status quo for Brittany and Jason, too. After scouting the boulevard, they make their way to Los Angeles' Skid Row to cop some dope. With their previous fix wearing off, Brittany and Jason make their way to the cleanest, safest refuge they know of in which to do their dirty business, the bathroom of a four-star hotel just a short walk from the very worst part of Skid Row.
Heroin addicts are forgetful. They don't remember.
Yeah.
You don't think.
And no matter how much you do remember, you still lie to yourself and say, well, I can just do it once and I won't do it tomorrow. And then tomorrow comes along and you're like, well, it's only been 2 days. I can do it today and it's okay. I just can't do it tomorrow because 3 days is too much and you're strung out. Tomorrow comes and you're like, I've done it 2 days in a row. It's almost a habit. I'm getting used to this again. I'm just gonna do it again, you know? And then like 2 days later, you're like, I'm totally sick. That's how you get into it.
I guess I'll always be an addict, but I really need to stop. Like, I'm really at that point where I can't do this anymore.
But Jason just can't seem to resist an old life beckoning, this piano in the lobby of the hotel.
Ever since I was 5 years old, I've been playing piano. I haven't played piano in a very, very long time.
So we are on Santa Monica Boulevard, and basically Santa Monica Boulevard is, you know, male prostitution boulevard. So mainly anyone that you see up and down this boulevard at this time of night walking around, maybe looking like they're waiting for the bus or looking like they're waiting for a phone call or whatever, chances are they might have something to do with doing the stroll down here.
Oh girl, he is so cute.
With few options, many kids reluctantly turn to prostitution, or as it's more commonly known out here, survival sex. This boulevard sees them all, from heterosexual to homosexual, transvestite, transgender, and transsexual.
Have you been hanging around that particular boulevard for a long time? You kind of involved in that stuff?
Santa Monica?
Yeah. There's the pause.
No comment.
No comment. All right. I respect that. I respect that.
How long have you been in LA?
3 months.
3 months. Is it all what you thought it was going to be?
Not at all.
What does that mean?
At first, I thought it was just all fun and games, just out having fun, doing what you want, being on your own. But once you really get out here and experience it, it gets hard.
It's not unusual for a kid to tell me, you know, I got picked up by this guy who's got, you know, his two baby seats in the back of his Land Cruiser, you know, and he's on his way home from work to his wife, but he stopped so that, you know, he could give me a job or that I can give him a job. These young people who are prostituting, these prostitutes in general, who do we as a world think is picking these people up? You know, these people aren't prostituting to themselves. These people are prostituting to the husbands and fathers of this country.
It's been just a few days since Tom's near-fatal overdose. And though he considers the episode itself no big deal, he's tired of the general path he's treading.
I grew up in a good family, but I think it's just dumb choices that I made that I regret making.
He stops in at the Los Angeles Youth Network, a Hollywood agency which has seen more than 600 kids like Tom each year since it opened in 1986. A hot meal at LAYN is a daily part of Tom's routine. But today he also meets with a caseworker to discuss his hopes of going home.
I just want to get back to Denver.
To Denver?
Yeah, I've been trying to do that for like a month and a half. And
what's in Denver?
That's my home. I have like employment waiting for me out there, possibly a home.
But like all addicts, Tom is caught in a vicious cycle he can't seem to put an end to.
I want to be able to stop permanently, you know. I was clean for like 5 months in Denver until I came out here. When I go back to Denver, I plan to like stay away from it again.
One thing he can control is his association with Al.
Hey, what's up?
Their relationship, like so many on the boulevard, has quickly disintegrated.
He wants to do heroin today, and if he's doing that, he used to do it like with someone else, because I don't want to contribute to that anymore. I mean, if he chooses me as a role model, he might become like me or want to become like me. And that's not a good decision because he's throwing his life away.
Despite Tom's advice, with each passing day, Al is sinking deeper into Hollywood's drug scene. Tonight, stoned and stumbling, he's even boastful about his latest hit.
The amount that Tom used to OD, I did about probably more. I got a whole nother needle. See? It feels good. Like, I usually feel like shit and I'm always angry and I hate this stuff. And like, now it's like, whoa. Hi, Mom, look at me. My mom would be torn up really bad. Because, like, she doesn't, like, really show it, like, all her feelings, but I know she cares a lot about me. Can't really rationalize what I'm doing now. It's just shooting poison into me. Making me sick. I'm disenchanted by life, I guess. It's not my thing.
Hi, Colin.
Coming up.
You know, I got a place to live now. Ain't nobody can say nothing about it. I knew I could do it. I just needed some time.
Sunday may be a day of rest for some, but the boulevard is alive with its usual buzz. The street performers and the walking billboards, the shopkeepers and the ticket takers, the newcomers and the old timers, they're all here.
How are you doing today?
And in front of the McDonald's on the corner of Hollywood and Highland, the kids have taken up their usual spots. Brittany and Jason are here, ready for business, and so is Tom, spanging in his own haphazard way. And though he's still in Hollywood, Tom has split with Al, just as he vowed, and is now squatting with a different group of friends.
Last night it was the field up there. Tonight it's probably gonna be the same place.
Jason has made some choices too.
Well, I'm done with the clinic. Brittany's still gonna try and get in. Well, when she goes, I'm just going to buy some methadone off the street, because my habit's really low right now.
Brittany and Jason run into Spider and find her relatively unfazed by the tumultuous events of the previous day.
Four doctors come in. All of them said she's fine, she's healthy, she looks good. The healthiest baby they've seen. I went home, we got in the hot tub, had a fun time, we celebrated. They did not take her from me. They're not ever going to take her from me. She's fine.
And things are looking up for Brittany, too. Somehow in the midst of spanging and not knowing where she's going to rest her head, she's gotten a job.
I haven't had a normal job for like over a year. It was really hard to wake up and come here. I want this nice apartment. And I gotta save money up for it. It's expensive. So, like, I'm doing something that might actually get me it. Instead of just about not having it.
She is training to work as a telemarketer.
My dad, this is all he ever wanted to do, was work in an office like this, be the big business executive guy. But he was always like, you know, total mess up. But like, he'd drive around in his little broken down Datsun, you know, piece of shit, started with a button, in his long trench coat and briefcase and fancy clothes and suits, and drive to court because he was in trouble with the law. So I was like, Dad, I got the office job you want, you know?
And while Brittany is attempting to earn money, Jason is collecting it from Uncle Sam. Though he knows one day he'll have to get a job, the prospect of employment is frightening.
I mean, all my life I've had jobs. I used to teach piano lessons. That's the only job I really loved to do. And, you know, it's like, what are the chances that I'm gonna get a great job again, where I'm gonna be able to, like, be creative and do what I wanna do? I wanna be a rock star, you know?
In the meantime, with his welfare check, he and Brittany have been able to get off the streets and move here into a seedy hotel on Skid Row.
It's shit compared to the other rooms. They're supposed to move us to another nicer room. This room has icky furniture and yucky carpet. The other rooms have nice carpet, nice comforters.
With each step forward, Brittany and Jason take another step back. Brittany's 18th birthday has come and gone, but she is no closer to checking into a methadone clinic.
Hi, Colin.
Just a few floors below, Spider is moving in. She qualified for money from the state and can now afford to pay for room 668.
Well, this is my room. I'm like just now starting to unpack.
There's blankets, receiving blankets, diapers, diapers. I got a changing. Oh my God, I have too much stuff. I even have our own picture hanging up already. Our first picture we took together. No, I got a place to live now, and nobody can say nothing about it. I knew I can do it. I just needed some time.
With a place for everyone to call home, the group heads out to celebrate. Brittany and Jason give Spider and her growing family a tour of the new neighborhood, which is just blocks from the worst part of Skid Row.
You go down there to Skid Row, I mean, those guys just trashed the whole place. They trashed themselves. We've seen guys piss on themselves. It's nasty shit, you know. They got no respect for anything. Yeah, this whole block right here is Pershing Square.
This is where Jason and Brittany spent their first nights in California.
This is where we slept, right about here.
To them, however, the idea that they could end up permanently homeless adults living in a tent on the sidewalk seems absurd, but not to Brian Bob.
What makes you think that you are not in line to take the place of the woman on the corner talking to herself? They weren't always there. And they won't always be there. Someone is gonna have to take their place.
There's nothing I can do about the past. So I try to look forward to the future as much as I can.
I don't know, just try to maybe find if there's something better out there.
As long as I feel bad still, then I'm not too far gone.
I can substitute music for heroin. It gets me high, man, it totally gets me high.
These kids are us, you know, they're our future. You know, they're amazing souls. You know, they're amazing young people who are brilliant and gifted and talented and forgotten.
My daughter will still be raised as a gutter punk. She will still be raised around the street kids. I'm gonna still raise her the way I wanna raise her.
Several months after we left Hollywood, we spoke with Allison, who had met a man and followed him to Texas, where she says he was teaching her to drive 18-wheelers. Jason sent an email in the summer of 2001 telling us he and Brittany moved on to a suburb of Los Angeles. They had scraped together enough money to rent a small apartment. A lucky break, Jason said. The apartment had an organ that let him keep up with his music. As for Spider, we spoke with her in 2002, and she told us she gave her baby to an acquaintance for safekeeping before she went to jail in the previous summer. After serving several months for a misdemeanor, she said she had been unable to find her baby. DCFS records show they've had no contact with Spider or the child since the summer of 2001. That's our report. I'm John Siegenthaler.